This video is sponsored by Texas Instruments. I-35 runs through the heart of Texas. A self-driving rover delivering Texas Instruments calculators leaves San Antonio at noon. It's headed north at 2 miles per hour. Another self-driving rover leaves Dallas-Fort Worth at the same time, headed south, going 1.5 miles per hour. Which town will have a front row seat to the unfortunate collision of our two rovers? And when can the town expect to see said collision? Hopefully that was a little more engaging than just reading the classic train word problem. Today, let's see how we can bring mathematics to life in our classrooms with our Texas Instruments calculators and TI Innovator Rovers. This lesson is ideal for an Algebra 1 classroom where you're learning intersection of lines and systems of equations, but you can differentiate if you teach a higher level mathematics, which I'll talk about later in the video. And stick around to the end of the video where I'm gonna tell you how you can actually win a couple of these Rover sets for your classroom for free. And this was actually really fun for me to do because I have only taught 5th, 6th, 7th grade math, and I got up to pre-algebra, and so I never really taught Algebra 1 or anything after that. A lot of these Algebra 1 concepts I haven't seen since high school or college. And so some of these things I actually had to stop and think, wait, how exactly would I do this again? But it was really fun for me to rediscover some of these mathematical concepts in a really conceptual and tangible way, and realizing when I learned it myself, I really just learned, oh, this number means you start here on the graph, and a really big number here means you've got a steeper slant. And so I share that because you might be thinking like, I don't know about these robots and these innovator hubs and electronics and stuff like that. But I encourage you to have a growth mindset about this. This could be a super fun learning experience for both you and your students. And who knows, maybe it will illuminate some of the mathematics for you too. I'll be working through a lesson document that I've created to help you and your students work through this activity. So these rovers are made up of three different elements. The TI 84 plus CE, you can have the one with Python or without Python, it'll work with either. You can also do this with the TI Inspire CX or CX2. You've also got the TI Innovator Hub, which your calculator connects to, and then this hub connects to the actual rover, which for the most part is pretty assembled when you get it. You just have to slide in the hub and then attach the calculator and then plug in a few cables. On my lesson document, I'm gonna have links on how to actually assemble this. So if you and your students are doing this for the first time, you can easily follow those directions. There is a specific program that you need to install on the calculator for this specific activity. And on that document, I'll also have a link on what software you need to download to your computer in order to install the appropriate program, as well as a link to the program. I recommend assembling the rovers and installing the programs onto them before you do any of the work with this activity. And so that way you're not making all this momentum in the word problem and then saying, okay, now let's stop for 30 minutes and start assembling these and downloading the programs and all that. The first thing you need to do is create a number line to serve as your highway. It's a vertical number line for a couple of reasons. First, I-35 is north and south and runs right through the heart of Texas. I'm working with Texas Instruments. I live in Austin, Texas. All of it kind of just came together too nicely in that regard. But the bigger reason is that this number line is going to be representing our y-axis later on when we get to the graphing portion of the activity. And it's going to be a lot easier for our students to make the connection of a vertical number line being the y-axis versus working on a horizontal number line, but then thinking about it later as the y-axis. Each unit on the number line is representing 1 mile in the word problem, and it has to be 10 centimeters apart on the actual physical number line that you draw in order for the program to run correctly. Obviously, the cities on my number line are much further than 1 mile apart, but I just wanted to put a lot of the big cities in Texas on the number line. You could also do this with a north-south street in your town and just use street names as your benchmarks. I think customizing it to a road that your students are familiar with will help contextualize it and make it a little bit more real for them, a little bit more tangible for them. I wrote the question with everything in relation to Austin, and so Austin is my zero on my number line. So when you present this to your students, I would first present the word problem, and you probably want to customize it for cities and towns and streets in your area, and then show them the number line, and then that's it. Just let them see what they can figure figure out. Don't worry about any equations or functions or graphs or anything like that right now. What can they figure out based on the information given and the number line that they are presented with? A few questions you can ask students if they're struggling to get started are, where is the first row ever starting on our number line? What direction is it headed? How fast is it going? Where is it going to be after 1 hour? What about after 2 hours? Can you write that down? Okay, so what about the second rover? Once they have a guess and they have an idea, like, okay, I think the collision's gonna happen at this place on the number line after this many hours, they can run the test with the actual rovers. You can put the rovers on the number line and you just match the front of the rover with the spot on the number line that they're starting. And then on their calculators, they'll just run the program, and the program is gonna ask them a few questions before it actually runs. And this is where they basically put their guesses in. The first question is, what's the velocity? We know the velocity is from the original word problem. So with our first rover, the velocity was 2 miles per hour. In the context of this demonstration, miles per hour are actually going to be units per second. So 2 miles for every 1 hour is actually gonna be 2 units on the number line, each unit being 10 centimeters. Every second. The next question it asks the students is, what's the position of the rover? Where on the number line in relationship to zero is our rover? The next question is, what is the time of intersection? How many hours, or in the demonstration, how many seconds is it going to take until these two rovers collide? What this number is doing is it's telling the rover how long to go at the velocity that they had written earlier. And so if they do everything right, the two rovers should basically come together and stop right when they collide, or maybe right before they collide, or just a little bit after they collide. Some students may say the time of intersection is 7 seconds, when in our example, it's actually going to be 4 seconds. And they'll think they got it right because the collision happened in the place that they thought it would happen, but the wheels are continually turning even after the collision. So one way to kind of point this out to them is say, in an effort to ensure that the collision does not destroy the whole town that they collide in, the rovers must stop upon collision. If your wheels are still going after the collision, you've done something wrong in your calculations. And the last question is asking the students for a delay. This is a situation where one of the rovers leaves later than the other one. It's on a 1 or 2 or 3 hour delay, or in this case, 1, 2, or 3 second delay in relation to the other rover. The original problem said they left at the same time, so our delay is actually 0 for both of them, but don't tell the students this right off the bat. If they ask you what it means, say, well, what do you think delay means? They love it when you do that. And have them refer back to the original problem. If you teach a higher level mathematics, you can change the problem up so one of the rovers does leave later than the other rover, and then this can become an exploration of a transformation of functions. And then after that, both students will have to hit enter at the same time and then see if they were correct. Did the two rovers collide when and where the students had predicted? If not, they can continue trying until they figure it out. So now we want to get them to see how this connects to linear functions and systems of equations. Ask students to draw a vertical number line similar to the one that you made for them, and then have them show you what happened. They'll probably say something like, oh, well, Rover 1 started down in San Antonio and headed up north, and Rover 2 started up in Dallas-Fort Worth and headed south, and they collided in Belton after 4 seconds. And ask them, how did you notate that it took them 4 seconds until they collided? They may kind of just stare at you for a second. We're trying to get them to see that right now, they are only seeing one dimension, the change in distance of these rovers. But how do we see that change in distance happening over time? Some students will start making these connections depending on how much you've done with linear functions to this point. For those that aren't, have them then draw a horizontal line through Austin through our zero and say this line is now representing time. So what would zero time mean? Well, zero time means nothing has happened yet. And what about our first rover? Where does it start? Well, it started down in San Antonio, which is gonna be -5. Okay, so zero time, we're at San Antonio, -5. What about 1 hour or 1 second in the demonstration? Well, it was going north, and so after an hour, it had gone 2 miles, and so it was in San Marcos. Okay, so let's write that. And what about hour number two? What about hour number three? Have them continue to plot this out. So then we want to create our function. Ask them, if I give you time, but it's represented by a variable t, would you be able to figure out the location of the rover, how far away it is from where it started? And students may likely say, yeah, so after 1 hour, I know I just multiply 1 hour by the 2 miles per hour. So it's just 2 times the amount of hours, or 2 times t. So after 1 hour, then it should be in the location of 2 miles north of Austin, because 2 times 1 is 2. And they're like, well, no, I mean, it started down in San Antonio. It didn't start in Austin. Oh, so how do we actually show that we're not starting at 0, we're starting way down in San Antonio of negative 5? Oh, well, we just have 2t minus 5, and then that will actually get us to our final destination after however many hours. So our function for distance from Austin, when time t is our variable, would be y equals 2t minus 5. You can decide how much of the function notation you want to introduce to them at this point. And then have them do this entire same thing with the other rover. They should be graphing both lines, and then that graph should be representing the experience that they had, that after 4 seconds or 4 hours in the word problem, the place where the two rovers met was 3 miles north of Austin. You may be tempted to start with the linear functions and then have them figure out where the point of intersection is by having a graph it and working on the systems of equations, and then introducing the rovers and the word problem and all sorts of things like that. But I implore you, start with something concrete that they can see and feel and understand, and then let that lead into the mathematics. Let math be used to explain the situation instead of creating the situation to explain the math. If you'd like the Google Doc that I created to walk you and your students through this activity, you can get it emailed to you using the link down in the description, and that will also add you to the new EdTech Classroom newsletter. You'll wanna be a part of that newsletter because that's how you're gonna find out when we are gonna do our big giveaway with Texas Instruments and sending a bunch of these rovers and calculators and hubs to teachers like you. So thanks so much for watching, and let me know if you have any questions about the lesson document. And once you get the lesson document, stay tuned for the email about the big giveaway.